Algerians may be in France, but they are shut out from equality with the French. Even more than black Americans, Algerians are denied any real influence. The French seem to believe that culture flows through the veins of society the way blood flows through the arteries of the human body, that culture is to society what blood is to the human person. Well, it's a measure of how seriously they take culture in human affairs and how this has influenced interracial relations. They say the French don't care who goes to bed with whom, provided the preliminaries are conducted in impeccable French. Well, it's a distinction between color prejudice and culture prejudice. In cultural discrimination, there's no doubt the French are worse offenders than the British. In color prejudice, it is the British that are the worst offenders. I grew up in a British colony. We were segregated, separate schools, separate lavatories, separate clubs. This wouldn't have happened if I'd grown up within a French colony. On the other hand, the first few years of my education were in my native tongue, a concession to an African language, something which would not have happened if I was the subject of France. Well, what are the Africans and people of African ancestry doing about these two levels of arrogance, the cultural and the color? In fact, two strategies have been manifest. One is to cut down white privileges in Africa and bring the whites to levels of equality. And secondly, is to raise the status of blacks and browns within Europe, also restoring them to a status of equality. The white settler era of privilege is beginning to come to an end. The legitimate black and brown settler era has just begun.
One way to protect yourself from becoming a pawn in other people's designs is to guard your heritage. Algerians bring with them to France their own cultural baggage, their own shops, their own food, their own religion. But the African cultural shield is mistaken for a political weapon by the host country. North African traditions are perceived as cultural aggression. Many French people feel challenged on their own sacred territory and see their national identity at risk.
The question of whether the Christian heritage of France is under threat has been seriously discussed in this country, with implications for the North African presence in France. Not so long ago, a former prime minister of France complained that while in the 19th century, France built churches and cathedrals in North Africa, today, North Africans are building mosques in France. And Islam is already more of a presence in this country than the Protestant faith is. North Africans are arriving here not to convert the French to Islam, but to coexist with them. Not to transform France into an Islamic state, but to turn the French into a multi-religious society.
As France has become less imperialist abroad, she has become more racist at home. Across Europe, the specter of racism looms ever larger.
The last time I was called boy was in the city. I was in a restaurant not very far from here. You know, I grew up in colonial Kenya. I was used to a white customer calling a black waiter boy. But this was a case of the waiter calling the customer boy. He was frantic. I was trying to gain his attention. And he said, "Wait, boy." I began to wonder, really, what was happening to France. You know, French people reading their newspapers every day have increasingly become aware of a new phenomenon: murder with a racial face. Murder happening sometimes out of pure hate, almost like Iago's hate of Othello. No special reason, sometimes not even racial ones. And yet, 10 to 12 murders every year connected with race. What's happening to this cultured country? What's happening to this beautiful city? Are we witnessing lynching with a French accent?
The Black Odyssey in America has dripped in blood for much longer than in Europe. Abraham Lincoln issued his Emancipation Proclamation to free the slaves, but blacks continued to be casualties of white racial violence for generations. Lynchings in the United States continued into the 1930s, but since World War II, America has become less racist, while Britain and France have become more prejudiced. The United States is still far from being the champion of Africa and the Third World. In fact, although the United States has become less racist at home, it has become more interventionist abroad. The United Nations is one arena of American external muscle.
When the founding fathers of the United Nations decided to locate the world body within the most powerful country in the world, they were making a political statement. They were entrusting peace to the mighty. For a while, the United States virtually became the custodian of world security, a kind of Pax Americana, policing the world under American leadership. And then came Africa's independence. In a single year, in 1960, more than 15 African countries became members of the United Nations. the largest influx ever. Did it make a difference? Well, it would be absurd to say that Pax Americana gave way to Pax Africana, that the meek inherited from the mighty the custody of human security. But a transition was taking place. The torch was being passed to a new generation of nations born in this century, hardened by a long and bitter deprivation. Here at the United Nations, the agenda of world order is being revised, and the mighty don't like it in the least. The developing countries had to look for alternative forms of influence in the world system beyond the United Nations. Oil has for a while been a powerful resource in the global equation. There is little doubt about the importance of Islam as a force in the political economy of oil worldwide. One could almost assert that where there are Muslims and there is sand, there may be oil. Of course, it's an absurd proposition, but sometimes it sounds almost like a law of nature. The majority of the members of the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries are, in fact, Muslim. Among the major exporters of oil generally, Muslim societies feature large. And the biggest and richest of them all is also the custodian of the holiest places of Islam, Mecca and Medina. But here's the rub. Is Allah, is God, angry with the Muslims, or is he pleased with them? Is the oil a blessing or a curse? Algeria has turned it into a blessing by making it a basis of development. On the other hand, there are many oil-rich countries that have become stagnant. The affluent society has become the indolent society. There is a third answer provided by Muslim fundamentalists. Every generation is given a chance to restore the credentials of Islam as a global force. This generation has oil. It is neither a curse nor a blessing. It is a historic opportunity. When Muammar Gaddafi came to power in Libya in 1969, he used oil as indeed such an opportunity for the greater glory of Africa as well as Islam. He saw himself as political heir to the late President Nasser of Egypt and the leadership of Nasser's three worlds of Islam, Pan-Africanism and Pan-Arabism. Because of his support for the Palestinian fighters, he also inherited from Nasser the Western world's hatred. To the West, Nasser was Hitler. Gaddafi was seen simply as a terrorist. He supported armed resistance against what he regarded as Western imperialism, but in so doing brought down upon himself the revenge of the West. American bombs dropped from the air killed children as surely as terrorist bombs left at an airport.
Civilized nations cannot continue to tolerate, in the name of material gain and self-interest, the murder of innocents. Gaddafi deserves to be treated as a pariah in the world community. We call on our friends in Western Europe and elsewhere to join with us in isolating him.
Gaddafi represents more than a political issue. He personifies a moral one as well. His own actions and the West's reactions bring out the double standards of both camps. Each side protests the rightness of its cause, and emotion gets in the way of understanding. Allah, Two supreme ideals seem to have inspired Gaddafi's adventures: to turn Africans and Arabs into masters of their own destiny and to transform them into major actors on the world stage. Gaddafi is another example of how it's not enough just to stop being pawns in the games of the powerful. We must become global players in our own right. More pervasive than military rivalries are economic ones. Here the question of who is player and who is pawn, who is acting and who is acted upon, is being played out all the time. They say that supply and demand is as important to capitalism as water is to human survival. In Africa, we call our women custodians of water. In the West, blind market forces are the custodians of the world's capitalist economy. The West allows supply and demand to determine the divide between the rich and the poor, between players and pawns in global relationships. If the first step on the ladder of wisdom is to know who we are, the second step is surely to know what we have and how to protect it. Africa is not really in control of her own resources. The West dictates the price it pays for our minerals and takes what it wants, when it wants. Africans need to unite to settle the real value of the natural resources. By banding together in OPEC, the oil producers changed their status with the West, as did Gaddafi. Africa has other chances to do the same.
Without some of the minerals that Zaire exports, it is estimated that up to a third of the air power of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization would be in serious trouble. Defense budgets going up, perhaps aeroplanes not in sufficient quantities. Civil aviation might also be affected. And because aeroplanes would become so expensive, perhaps several of the major international airlines would have to close down.
Another of Zaire's minerals, uranium, played a part in some of the earliest atomic experiments. In that sense, Zaire was present at the birth of the nuclear age. But again, African resources were being used for other people's purposes. Zaire has been trying to become a nuclear player since independence. The Belgian-built reactor in Kinshasa was the first in Africa. In a sense, Zaire has been refuting the Western assumption that nuclear know-how is not for Africans and children under 16. Much more advanced than in Zaire is nuclear technology in South Africa. In this racial society, it is shown off but not shared. Ghana's founder president warned Africans about two dangerous swords: nuclear power in hostile hands and racism. Today, both swords hang over South Africa.
That's uranium.